وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه ومن اهتدى بهديه والسنة والسلام الدين. We covered ayah 85 last time, but just quickly to connect the dots. ويسألونك عن الروح قل الروح من أمر ربي وما أوتيتم من العلم إلا قليلا. Now the disbelievers ask the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, and we talked about that they went and asked him few questions, and this was what the Jews told them. They say, we're going to give you a few questions. If he answers them, he's a prophet. If he does not answer them, he's not a prophet. One of them was Ruh, one of them was Dhul Qarnayn, okay? And also Ahl al-Kahf, the people of the cave. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يسألونك عن الروح. These people ask you about the Ruh. Now, in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used the word Ruh for different meanings, okay? But Jibreel, عليه الصلاة والسلام, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala called him Ruh. Okay, الوحي revelation Allah سبحانه وتعالى تروح الروح Allah سبحانه وتعالى when Allah سبحانه وتعالى أيدهم بروح منه when Allah سبحانه وتعالى strengthen your stand he used this but the روح he does Allah سبحانه وتعالى talk about is the thing the secret that Allah breathed in us that give us life okay that is whatever Allah سبحانه وتعالى What if there is something called an-nafs and there is something called ar-ruh? Ar-ruh, if it leaves your body, you're done. Okay?
Ruh, till today, no one knows what is that.
No, that's what Allah
says. Some people say nafs is the same as ruh.
No.
Other people say no, ruh is different from the jasad, from nafs, from everything.
It is totally different. Because the Quran also says different. الله سبحانه وتعالى سي الله يتوفى الأنفس حين موتها والتي لم تمت في منامها so النفس is something Allah سبحانه وتعالى knows what it is but النفس is something that can depart your body but you do not die you understand and the علماء say this is how you dream okay my نفس when I dream when I sleep My nafs can go to Egypt or to go to India, go any place. You understand this? If I die, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala,
He said. The ruh as well, according to your explanation right now, the ruh can go anywhere.
No, the ruh cannot leave the body. The ruh is what gives you life. That does not leave the body, okay? But in nafs can leave the body. Okay, but in nafs when it comes back in the body, now my nafs now is in here. It is controlled by the my own body. Cannot leave as long as I am awake. It is whatever control the body control the nafs. But once you sleep, the nafs can depart. Okay, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He say. When people sleep, some of them I will bring the nafs back, and some of them I will keep it. If he decides to keep the nafs, it's not going to come back to the body. He also will take the ruh. You understand? Okay. Okay. Tafadhal.
هي الروح الروح يعني من الله سبحانه وتعالى ونفخ فيه من روح.
Yes.
إذن هي is connected with Allah with Allah سبحانه وتعالى something secret something from Allah directly.
Yes, it's true.
Yes.
And this is what the ulama say. They say when Allah سبحانه وتعالى address the angels, Allah سبحانه وتعالى say when I fashion Adam, yeah. إني خالق بشرا من طين فإذا سويته استنى إذا سويته يعني الله سبحانه وتعالى fashioned him he molded him until that point he is more all a piece of dirt okay nothing but الله سبحانه وتعالى says فإذا سويته ونفخت فيه من روحي فقعوا له ساجدين so the angels What give us that honor and that high maqam is not our body, it is the ruh. Okay, and this is what makes us different from other creature. Okay, other creatures, cows, stuff like that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not breathe in them ruh. You understand this? But because we have that holy thing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that will give us the honor. Okay, so that's what the ulama say. When you suffocate your ruh, when you live in this dunya like an animal, you actually what Allah honored you with, you reject, and you become a lot less than an animal. What make you and I a human being is not the body, it is what Allah breathed in us. This is ar-ruh.
Yeah, it says
ونفس.
What's the meaning of that?
ونفس وما سواها. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say that your nafs, the nafs is what feed the heart. Okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when we are born, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, في أحسن تقويم, the best shape. This is when we are born. Like أولاد. We are born in this. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sawaha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala perfected the nafs. فألهمها فجورها وتقواها. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala perfected the nafs. We are born at the best, the highest level a human being can be. Because you are totally on the fitrah. You're not tainted with anything. And it is our job. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made in this nafs the ability to go high or to go low. فَأَلْهَمَهَا فُجُورَهَا وَتَقْوَاهَا. The nafs itself, based on us, we can make this nafs. You can train yourself to become better than an angel, and you can lower your nafs until you are a lot less than hayawan, than animal. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, وَلَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِيمٍ. This is the best thing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give the nafs. And this is some of the ulama say, this is what we call the free will. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to agree and disagree, to look into things, to decode, to ponder, to think, and then we make decisions. So some of us will train their nafs to be high, because the nafs is the one that feed the heart. Okay, so the more you elevate your nafs, that is the way to go. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sawaha means form it. Is like when you taswiya fi al-tabikh, you know, the taswiya means this perfect. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it perfect, sawaha, fashioned it at the best shape. And then it is up to us. The Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, أحسن تقويم ثم رددناه أسفل سافلين إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات. We can take our nafs lower than an animal, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, the only people who keep it at the way I did it and take it even one niche higher, people who are constantly praying and connected with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Naam.
I think you put it really nicely, because that's where I'm...
That's very nice of you.
The ruh to me is definitely something from Allah.
Yes.
And the nafs is what we use.
Everything is from Allah.
No, but the ruh, without it, you're dead.
But you did.
Without it, you still have ruh.
Without the nafs?
Without the nafs, you can, as you said, you can take it up or low or so. This is what we really function in our daily activities, using the nafs. But the ruh is something that Allah breathed into us. And if it goes away, the nafs goes away too.
Absolutely.
So it's just like two things.
Two things, but you need to understand that, think about this. My own body is no different, forget about the shape, but it constitute my body is the same molecule that constitute a tree, and that the same molecule that constitute a pig or hyena, the same exact thing, okay? But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with his marvelous power of creation, he give us that shape, okay? But that shape is not differentiate us from one another. So what differentiate us? We have two parts. We have an earthy part, which is this, and a high part from Allah is the ruh. The problem with us, we only feed and take care of this. But the other part, which is really connecting us with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we suffocate it. We do not really care about it. You understand this? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is the balance. That as you feed your body, the physical body, as you feed it and you take care of it, if you do not feed your ruh, and the feeding the ruh is by connecting it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the source of this, something is made, can run only on electricity. Okay? It has to be connected, you understand? The ruh is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, although everything is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but the ruh is what make you and I a human being. We have, as a human being, we have to nourish both of them. As we nourish the body, and take care of it, and we run and keep it in shape, we have to do the same thing with the ruh. And the ruh, the nourishment for the ruh is worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is sticking with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
And then we'll go through the nafs.
Huh?
We'll go through the nafs.
No.
In order to nourish the ruh, it has to be through the nafs, what we do in our daily
life. Here is the thing that I do not want you to be confused. Okay, this is something just to differentiate between things. You understand that there is something called nafs and something called ruh. When you lower your nafs, when you live like an animal, okay, you actually suffocating your ruh. Because you cut that connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You understand? When I say suffocating the ruh, does not mean you're gonna die. You're not gonna physically die. You're gonna spiritually die. You understand that? Okay.
So the animals have nafs.
We do not really care about what animals have.
No, but because that's a big deal.
No.
If you kill an animal and then it doesn't have that ruh, then you are a criminal.
We're not. Of course, we does not have the ruh that a human being has, because that's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want you to understand one thing. We cannot do philosophy. What I mean by this, what Allah say, this is halal, it is halal. We do not have to do philosophy here. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, al-an'am, these cattles, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created for us. Huh? You drink the milk and you eat the flesh. You understand this? So you really do not have to get in these fine details, because
it's not philosophy, Shafri. This is more like,
I know you're not a philosopher.
It is, they don't have ruh.
Whatever you say, I agree.
There's no ruh in them.
It does not have the ruh that you and I have. Is not a creature that's connected to Allah in that manner.
All these are like population. They pray to Allah.
Listen. I know what you're saying, but just listen to me. Now, there is something called al-fitra. You understand this? It is all other creatures. If you look back, you're just going to take us out of this context here. If you go back, even the skies, the earth, every creature originally had free will. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, ثُمَّ قَالَ لِلسَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ اِتِيَا طَوْعًا Not the amana now. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, the earth, and the sky. I'tiya taw'an aw karhan. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives them a choice, what does this mean? That they have a choice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, come on your own terms, or you're gonna come by force. قَالَتَا أَتَيْنَا طَائِعِينَ, which means, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also, the ayah that the Shaykh just recite, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala offer that amana, which is free will, to all the creatures, and they refused to take it. You understand this? So animals have what we call fitra, okay? They know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not gonna hold them responsible for their acts. You understand this? We can get in more details than this. Of course, on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will resurrect everything, even the animals. Okay? And if two animals, an animal beat an animal, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise them and make the other one beat him, and he say, "Kunu turab." Okay? So, but we do not want to get in the fadl.
In a way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala هنا يعني أمرنا في هذا في هذه الآية إن إحنا يعني موضوع الروح ما نتكلمش فيه كتير, لأنه هو كل الروح من أمر ربي وما أوتيتم من العلم إلا قليلا.
Yes.
الروح يعني ما ندخلش فيها.
But when people ask you, you cannot tell them shut up.
No.
You have to tell. You have to comfort them.
Something related to the human being and related to our behavior.
Yes. It's two different things.
We keep it decide, which is the secret of our life.
All we say is this is something from Allah that keep us alive, but what is it? Constitutive of what? Nobody knows. Okay? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, don't even get into that. Because no matter how intelligent you are, you do not equipped with that type of knowledge. وَمَا أُوتِينَ عِمْ إِلَّا قَلِيلٌ. يعني the most knowledgeable person among us. And this is the ulama say, this is not really to put the brakes on our brains. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to think and ponder and all these things. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, I want to give you an advice. There are things are totally beyond your ability to figure out. Don't waste your time doing it. Because no matter how good you are, 2 billion years from now, when science become whatever it is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he told you, with that knowledge at that time, nobody can figure out what the ruh is. Nobody will figure out when the day of judgment is. There are things that we really cannot put time and effort to try to figure this out, because he cannot. Okay? And the Prophet ﷺ, one day when somebody told him, Mata sa'a, when is the hour? The answer was, what did you prepare for it? So instead of shutting him up, the Prophet ﷺ directed him to something. Instead of saying, if I tell you it's going to be in 2040,
It used to be 2012.
How is this going to help you? It's not going to help you. But the reality is, questions like this, what did you prepare yourself for? Okay. وَمَا أُوتِيتُمْ مِنْ قَلِيلٍ. We talked about this also last week in details. وَلَئِنْ شِئْنَا لَنَذْهَبَنَّ بِالَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ ثُمَّ لَا تَجِدُ لَكَ بِهِ عَلَيْنَا وَكِيلًا. Indeed, had we so willed, we could most surely have taken away that which we have revealed to you, where you would never find a guardian to plead with us for it in your behalf. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that this deen, this revelation, is tremendous ni'mah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Huh? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, وَلَوْ شِئْنَا, if I would have willed, I would not send that revelation. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so merciful. He created us And he does not want us to live with superstition, with all that hardship. You know something, when people lived for a long time before Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, see from Isa alayhi wasallam and the deviation, how many thousands of years? So they lived in total misunderstanding of what Allah is. Okay, so Christianity took Isa alayhi wasallam. Superstition was the call of the day. Okay, false assumption, illusion, delusion. Okay, tremendous anxiety, burden, fear. You know, people used to say when there is thunder, they say the angels are fighting. Okay, we have to do something to calm them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created us. He did not only give us physical and material provision, but he gave us also spiritual provision. You understand? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, I created you, but I did not let you go astray. I give you all the faculties. And there are things beyond your faculties. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us the universe and stuff like this, but he also sent us prophets, he sent messengers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he sent the books, he sent all kind of things for us, all the questions that people did not know before, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would lead them to guidance. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, if I ever did, and I just let you live astray, who can argue that point with us? ثُمَّ لَتَجِدُ لَكَ بِهِ عَلَيْنَا وَكِيلٌ. We cannot go hold Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responsible. لَا يُسْأَلُ عَمَّا يَفْعَلُ وَهُمْ يُسْأَلُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only one who can question us, but we cannot question Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? إِلَّا رَحْمَةً مِّن رَبِّكَ. I, Father Mawlana, لو انت عاوز توكل على الله ربنا يكرم. البشمهندس, he's going to pick his son from the airport. Oh. So he has to leave.
Okay. Drive safely.
You know, when you think about the revelation, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala taught us. The Prophet used to make a dua. الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا ان هدانا الله. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم never really thank Allah سبحانه وتعالى and being grateful to Allah for more than anything, more than the revelation. Everything else in this dunya actually really has no, is insignificant when you compare it to the spiritual help that Allah سبحانه وتعالى. Alhamdulillah, praised Allah سبحانه وتعالى, thanked Allah سبحانه وتعالى. You know, people worship people. People worship the sun. People make idols and worship it. Okay, how stupid this can be? You understand? You make your own god. What does this god wants from you? You understand this? And when you make your own god and worship it, you actually say, I am lower than this. When you plead with this, if I took this and ask, please cup, give me something. You understand? What I am really saying is that this cup is much higher than me. I am lower than this cup. You understand this? Now, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when the Sahaba who lived in Jahiliyyah, when they understand Tawheed, the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they protected with everything that they have, to the point that they hated anything that reminded them of Jahiliyyah. You understand this? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, this is a tremendous rahmah. Because unfortunately, all the time, we only thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when something materialistic happened to us. Okay, when I get a promotion, when I get a sum of money, when I do this, when I succeed in here, when I succeed in here. Always worldly things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, the thing that you really should be grateful to me more than anything else is that spiritual guidance that I gave you. Because without that spiritual guidance, people living in delusion, people demeaning themselves by worshipping things which is lower than them, all these things. إِلَّا رَحْمَةً مِّن رَبِّكَ إِنَّ فَضْلَهُ كَانَ عَلَيْكَ كَبِيرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, this is only a mercy from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a tremendous blessing. Indeed, إِنَّ فَضْلَهُ كَانَ عَلَيْكَ كَبِيرًا. Indeed, ever has his favor upon you being great. Here is the thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala absolutely, he put the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he say, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. We put you in a lofty station. Okay? The Prophet, think about the Prophet. Not a split of a second in any day until the day of judgment, the people not praising Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Isn't it? Yeah. Think about it. In every place, throughout 24 hours.
You mean the Muslims
praising? Huh?
Muslims, yeah.
Of course the Muslims, okay? Even the not non-Muslims, some of them praise Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, lots of them praise him. They do not believe in what he say, but they praise him. They choose him as the number one guy in the world. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرًا. Think about all the people who oppose Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They are in the garbage dump of the history. Nobody remembered them. Who normally talk about Abu Lahab, Abu Jahl? Who talk about them? But Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in every adhan, in every salah, which is being done around the clock, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad. So Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, wa rafa'na laka dhikra. So his station, his lofty station, is excellence among human beings. Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam made him the leader of all the prophets. The status, he is the seal of the prophets. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give him the highest station in paradise, okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made him receive the Quran, which is the continuous, everlasting miracle. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give him the biggest nation, the biggest followers. Some people say, no, because Christians throughout the history are much larger than the Muslims. That's not true, okay? What I mean by this, Real Christians are only fractions comparing the Muslim. You understand? The only nation that actually follow Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, of course we deviate, we do stupid things and stuff like this, but the Muslim nation is the biggest nation until the day of judgment. Okay? قل لئن اجتمعت الإنس والجن على أن يأتوا بمثل هذا القرآن لا يأتون بمثله ولو كان بعضهم لبعض ظهير. الله سبحانه وتعالى again is challenging us and challenging Quraysh and challenging humanity until the day of judgment. الله سبحانه وتعالى say if the entire humanity and the jinn, they all come together, we're gathered together to produce the like of this Quran, they could not produce the like thereof, even if they are backing each other and supporting each other. Fadal.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here added the jinn to it.
Ah, yes.
And we really never really know the jinn or their abilities and all that kind of stuff. I mean, I'm just wondering why Allah
subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay. Two things. The first one, the jinn is the second creature that they are going to be responsible on the day of judgment, like you and I. Because the jinn is a creation like you, like human being, and they have messengers, and they are following also Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So they are responsible before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala he said, قُلْ أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ أَنَّهُ اسْتَمَعَ نَفَرٌ مِّنَ الْجِنِّ فَقَالُوا إِنَّا سَمِعْنَا قُرْآنًا عَجَبًا. The jinn are following from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Okay? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, people who have you know, they are commissioned. Okay, this is the two creation that are commissioned, and they are ordered to do and not to do, is ins and the jinn. Okay, so Allah Subhanahu wa Taala, He say, if both you creation, both of you, get together, try to reduce something like this, you're not gonna be able to. And he's challenging Quraysh, because Quraysh, that was their subject. The Arabic language, there were writers, there were poets and stuff like this. But look at the accuracy of the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He talk about physical ability, He start with the jinn. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, Ya ma'ashara al-jinni wal-ins, in istata'atum an tanfudhu min aqtari as-samawati wal-ard. Oh, you, jinn and the ins, if you have the power to go out of the outskirts of samawati wal-ard, tanfudhu, go. You're not going to be able to do it. He started with who? Jinn. Because the jinn physically have a lot more ability than us. They can move as they want. So when it comes to physical ability, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk about jinn. When He talked about verbal and putting words, and articulating words, in this ayah start with ins, human being. You understand this? If you look at these ayat, these are tremendous proof that this Quran is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, an illiterate man who articulates something like this? And who even think about this? When you read these ayat, you might not even realize that this ayah starts with human being and the other ayah starts with jinn. Who can articulate something like this? You understand this? So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk about the physical ability, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts with the jinn, because they have the power. But when he talk about mental ability, the way to articulate words and to put things, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk about ins. But also in the Quran, this is something we need to understand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from day one, He challenged humanity to duplicate the Quran. Okay? In this surah, this is the first challenge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala challenged us, humanity, and the jinn, to duplicate the Quran. أن يأتوا لا يأتوا على أن يأتوا بمثل هذا القرآن. كويس؟ I want you to duplicate. Give me something like this Quran. Okay? So this is the first challenge. But Allah سبحانه وتعالى then lowered the bar. Okay? And in Surah Hud and in Surah Yunus, Allah سبحانه وتعالى say, يأتوا عشر سور. The Quran is what? 115 surah. 114 surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Yunus and Hud, أَمْ يَقُولُونَ افْتَرَى, you say that Muhammad faked that. فَأْتُوا بَعَشْرِ سِوَرٍ مِثْلِهِ مُفْتَرَيَات. Give me 10 surah. That's the second challenge. The third challenge, which is the lowest challenge, He say one surah. But if you look at every, He say, in everyone He say, mithlihi, exact match. At the last challenge, He say, come with one surah, and it does not have to be a match. Min mithlihi, not mithlihi. Min mithlihi means that something resembles it. You understand? You see, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took that challenge from an entire Quran, a match. Then 10 ayat, 10 surah, a match. And then one surah, not doesn't have to be a match. It is something when you read it, it reminds you of the rhythm of the Quran. You understand? Okay. Now, one of the scholar he say, "Wallahi, this is so beautiful. When you look at the Quran, how difficult to match the Quran. Think about this. The language, its eloquence, total command in the language, which we call the Arabic rhetoric. Okay, this is al-nahw. Okay, al-balagha. Al-balagha means rhetoric. You cannot really find a language better than that. Okay, not only this. Think about Surah Al-Fatiha. Huh? Surah Al-Fatiha. Give me a poem or a paragraph that you can read it 17 times a day, your entire life, and you don't get sick of it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us a surah to prove that this Quran is from Him. If you read something, even the best poem, huh? And you read it 17 times a day, at least 17 times a day, because we pray more than 17 rak'ah. Huh? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He say, the way this Quran can never get old. You understand this? You look at the knowledge that it contains, the excellence, content, the refinement of the expression, the absence of inconsistency within the text. You look at the Bible contradict each other. Okay, there is absolutely, positively no contradiction in the Quran. The scientific miracles of the Quran, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are lots of things now is coming through that nobody knew before. Okay, and we discover the social miracles, the linguistic miracles, the legislative miracles. Sheikh Al-Buti, rahmatullahi alayhi, one of the things he say, the Quran was totally accepted, and he gave a beautiful analogy. He say, if you go to a very primitive society, and you talk, they never really seen electricity, and you talk to them about traffic lights, what does this mean? Who are you talking to? Who understand anything? And he say, the Quran, when he legislate, exactly done this. You understand this? These are very primitive society, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talked to them about things that they could not comprehend at that time, but it was totally acceptable. Imagine if you go to now up to primitive society with ulum, there is a traffic light, you have to do this when it turn, you understand this? Now, the financial system, look at the Quran. The financial system, the marriage system, the divorce system, the inheritance, huh? Even non-Muslims, and I want you to know this. I do not know if you know that in Germany, after World War II, there was demonstration. You can look this up in Google. This is a true thing, that women would go demonstrate in the street, and they have banners that we need to adopt the marriage system in Islam, because there was hundreds of thousands of women that did not get married. Men died, you understand? So they want to adopt that. If you remember, and this is something you probably, we all see, when there was that financial meltdown that happened with the Bush, the son, when he was the president. You remember the banners in Wall Street? That we want to adopt the financial system, which is zero interest. And this is what they did. You understand? So people, even when they do not believe in Islam, they actually gonna come to believe in the system that Islam provided, whether they believe in Islam or not. You understand? That's why Sheikh Sharawi, he say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make this deen prevail over all other deens. And he say that does not mean that the Muslim will overtake other religion. Is even other religion that they really do not believe in Islam, they will adopt the social system and the financial system and the inheritance system. You just look at economists. They tell you that the most fair inheritance system in the whole world is the Islamic thing. You understand this? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, you can never, it is not a poetry, because people think that Allah's challenging them in making something that rhymes like the Quran. That's not it. He's talking about the meat of the Quran, not something ridiculous that sound like the Quran. Some people, when the ayat came, they invented some ya dufda'atu ya dufda'in nisfiki fil ma'i wa nisfiki fil tin. This is something happened because the stupidity think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling them match the rhythm of the Quran. No. He's talking about the meat inside the Quran, the beautiful system that the Quran is talking about. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the fine details talk about inheritance, what you do, what do you have to do, everything. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk about marriage, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk about divorce, did not leave anything not explained in the Quran. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he say, you can never do that. You can never match the Quran. You can never match 10 surah. You know something? You cannot even make one surah that only resemble from a distance the Quran. واضح؟ تفضل.
It just reminds me of this ayah that I tried to memorize.
Yes.
Then Allah says, هو الذي أرسل رسوله بالهدى ودين الحق
ليظهره على الدين
كل دينه
على الدين كله على الدين كله ولو كره الكافرون. This is exactly the ayah I was referring to.
Oh, okay.
And he say, which is really, I think, that is the best interpretation. There could be different. He say, the deen here does not mean that the Quran will overtake all the other books. He say, the systems in the Quran will twist the people's arm. When you see in the United States of America and in Europe, when the meltdown happened, and they say we have to adopt the Islamic ruling because in order to get out of this, interest rate has to be zero, and they did that. You remember? Okay. So everything. Just think about marriage. Think about in Islam, Allah discourage divorce. But it has to be event, okay? In Christianity, you cannot. You can have affairs, but you cannot divorce your wife. You understand?
You know, Sheikh Fareed, the ayah that I just recited. I this is my personal belief.
Yes.
That inshallah, in the end, Islam will prevail.
Absolutely.
All religions.
No doubt. No doubt. But the don't forget. The Quran, one of the beautiful things about the Quran is the interpretation of the Quran in every period in history has to be understood. You understand this? Yes, maybe at the end there will be only mu'min. We have no doubt about that. But even with the majority of people who are not mu'min, they will come to realize whether they think that this system, because Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was uniquely intelligent, Superman, that's fine. They can think anyway. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say the system that it is uniquely put in the Quran can never be matched. You understand? Okay.
Finish at 8
today, right? Yes. Inshallah, Rabbil Alameen. We are done. Inshallah, next week, we're going to start, Sheikh Imad. We're going to start with Ayah 89, inshallah.